speak this afternoon, if you all don't mind. So he's going to go first instead of at 6 o'clock. He's going to talk right now and address the board with some ADD issues, okay? Thank you very much. Let's give him a round of applause, Dr. Tom.
Appreciate the opportunity to be here, and good evening. President Brown, Ms. Huey, thank you for an opportunity to come and visit with you about a very difficult situation, a situation that none of us like to find ourselves in ever, whether we're in the Department of Education or a school board, or whether we're a patron, a student of a school district that finds itself in a predicament in which this school district has more or less found itself now. And as Ms. Huey says, I'm Tom Carefore, Commissioner of Education, and it's my pleasure to serve the governor and the state board in this position. And to be honest with you, this is not the first time I've been in this position in front of school boards and students and patrons talking about Act 60 and the fact that your school district is in a position in which for 4 or 2 years, you've ended the year with less than 350 students. And by state statute, that means that this is the last year the Stevens School District, as it is today, in its organization and operations will exist. There's not a thing that I can do to change that. There's not a thing that the governor can do to change that. And short of a special session in which the legislature took up the issue of the Act 6350 number, there's nothing that the state of Arkansas can do to change that. To be honest with you, the very first state board meeting that I had the privilege of working as commissioner was in October of 2009. And the first recommendation that I had to make was to close the school district where I began my elementary grade, went through the fourth grade, where my dad was the school superintendent. And his first superintendent's and first principal's job at the Colonel School District. So it's something that I've dealt with personally. Now I have had to deal with a couple of different times as commissioner with districts that have found themselves in this position. Now, most of you are familiar with the Lakeview lawsuit or law case that you've heard about, and it was from that Lakeview law case that we find ourselves where we are today. In response to that, the legislature, the General Assembly, passed what we all refer to as Act 60. And this happened in 2003. What this act did is it consolidated all districts that were below 350 for more than two or more consecutive years. And that's why we're here today, tonight, to talk to you about what your options are and what you're facing as a board and as a community. 2011-2012 school year, Stevens School District, end of the year, three-quarter average AD of 333 students. 2012-13, last year, there was 344 students as the average daily membership. This school year, this 13-14 school year, is what we term the transition year. This is the year in which, under the law, you will have this opportunity this year to either voluntarily annex to or be consolidated with another school district, or whether you allow the state school board to involuntarily consolidate your district with another district. Now, that would probably include districts that would be contiguous if the state board looked at this matter and had to make a determination under an involuntary consolidation. As you know, you're contiguous with the Beta County School District, the Camden Fairview School District, the Smackover School District, and also Magnolia. Now, I want to make sure everybody understands there's a difference between annexation and consolidation. Under our definition in law of an annexation, it occurs when you join one or more school districts with an existing or receiving district. For instance, if District A annexes into District B, then basically what you have is District B absorbs District A, so you still have District B. Under consolidation, it's a little bit different in that when two districts consolidate or one new school district, then A and B become District C. So you have a totally different school district under a different board and a different operational perspective. Now, because your districts fall below 350 two consecutive years, we're facing this option. One of two options, really. First option is your school board has the option of finding and working with a district or districts to voluntarily consolidate or annex with. If you choose that option as a board, then you would submit a petition to the state board for approval. You have until March 1st, 2014 to do that. That's the deadline. If the state board does not receive a petition from your board and any other district or districts that voluntarily want to annex or consolidate with Stephen School District, then you've missed your opportunity to do that. After March 1, without that petition, then the second option occurs. That option then would be a involuntary consolidation determined by the state board of education. That has to be done by May 1 of 2014. Either one of those options becomes effective July 1, 2014. Now, a voluntary consolidation is preferable. It's preferable for a couple of reasons. One, it allows you as the district to negotiate with contiguous districts or other districts to fully explore what all options there are that would be preferable for you, the students that you serve, the patrons that pay the taxes to educate children. If you present a voluntary petition, the state board only has the option of denying that if it violates a state law or a federal law, or if it would not contribute to the betterment of the education of students in the school district. That's happened one time. In the situation in which Wiener, a school district in East Arkansas, Northeast Arkansas, had fallen below 350 for two consecutive years, they brought forth a petition to voluntarily consolidate with Delight. Now those districts were 186 miles apart. The state board did not feel like that was in the best interest and would contribute to the betterment of the education of those students, and they denied that. Subsequently, they came back with a voluntary consolidation petition with Harrisburg, which was a contiguous district just, I believe, just a little bit west of Wiener. Now, I tell you that today that that was brought early, much earlier than March 1, because if it had not been after March, then you run into some real tight timelines. If, for instance, March 1, we get the petition, if we're not within the two-week window that we have in order to place that on the agenda, and a lot of that just depends on when March 1st lands, our state board meets on the second Monday of each month, then you could be looking at not having an option. That's why we encourage districts that find themselves in the same position that you find yourself, in really searching and bringing a petition as early as possible, as early as January, February, in order to have more options in case the state board have questions or concerns about the petition that you may bring. Now, there's a couple things that have to exist in order for, and requirements in order for consolidation to occur. One, the resulting school district has to have more than 350 students. And back when Act 61st became law, there were some school districts that were actually below 140 students. And you had a couple who actually, when they wanted to consolidate, when they brought two together, they didn't have 350 students. So those were denied automatically. You cannot create a school district that would, through annexation or consolidation, that would hamper, delay, or in any way negatively affect the desegregation of another school district in this state. So what we typically do is we take, if there is a situation in which there may be conversations between the Stevens School District and the contiguous district, we would ask for an Attorney General's opinion as to whether that consolidation or annexation would create or hamper or delay desegregation efforts anywhere else in the state. The third thing that you have to remember is that your tax rate remains the same as if it was voted. So if District A and District B decide that they want to voluntarily consolidate, then District A's tax rate would remain the same as it is today. District B would remain the same as it is today until an election could be held in September to either equalize those or go to an equalized village. Now, for instance, in your case, I think your millage rate is 34 mills, and Camden Fairview's is 41. Those two would stay the same until an election in which a positive vote would occur to equalize those millages. Now, currently in the state of Arkansas, we have school districts that are results of consolidations or annexations in which patrons are paying different millage rates because they've not been able to vote an equalized millage. Fourth, the resulting district can only have one superintendent and one school board. And again, there are laws that govern how many board members can actually serve on a school board. If you're familiar, you've been to school board association training, you know that's five or seven members. Which brings me to my next point. If you choose to go voluntarily into an annexation or consolidation, there are a couple of different laws that apply to how your board makeup occurs. If you voluntarily find a consolidation or annexation partner, there's greater flexibility in how the board actually is made up. It actually becomes an agreement between the two districts that choose, or three districts that choose to annex or consolidate. If it's an involuntary consolidation, in other words, you don't come to the state board with a petition, then the state board will determine who the school board will be. And that's always not as welcoming as being able to work with the flexibility. We have templates, Ms. Huey, on our website that will give you those petitions and help walk through that process for voluntary annexation. They're in a Word format, so you can tailor them to meet your requirements in particular circumstances. So we encourage districts, as they're working together, looking at those possibilities, to be able to be sure and seek legal counsel from your legal counsel and the districts that you're talking to seek counsel from theirs, and to look and present those petitions in agreements that can be brought forward by both boards or three boards if there is a situation that occurs there. Because we've had situations where back early when Act 60 first came in, when you had more than two districts who chose to consolidate together to form one school district. The final piece that I wanted to talk about is the funding that occurs. In consolidation and annexation, the state provides funding to help with that transition. That transition occurs over a period of 2 years. And what happens is if a school consolidates or annexes with another school, the resulting school district is provided what is called consolidation annexation incentive funding. That is foundation funding up to 300 students max. So for a district such as yours that has over 300 students, whatever would occur, voluntary or involuntary, that's about one point, I believe, a little over $1.9 million the first year. I'm sorry, a little over $1.1 million the first year. And then the second year of the consolidation and annexation, the resulting district gets half that money again to help with those transition needs in either transportation costs, renovation costs, construction costs, etc., of the things that many times people who go through annexation consolidations don't realize is that when you become one school district, you have one salary schedule. So your salary schedules have to be equalized. That's typically a cost to one district or another, depending upon which district has the highest salary schedule. And it's very difficult sometimes, I think, to get school districts, particularly staff members, to vote a lower salary schedule than what the salary schedule is for the school district that has the highest salary rates. Now, that's really where we're at today. I don't know, again, what else to tell you except to tell you there are two options. No one. You know, we've heard, I guess, stories coming out of the area down here. We've received emails, we've received letters, we've received phone calls that our school district is looking to try to get more students in this year so they can end this school year with more than 350 and not have to close. That is not an option. The law doesn't allow for that option. This is the transition year, as we call it, for the Stephen School District. So what I wanted to be able to ensure you is that we will help you through this transition as much as we possibly can. We will give you what information that we have as far as how to go about petition and guidance in bringing that forward to the state board. My encouragement to you is, and I appreciate you having these meetings, and I understand you've had other meetings prior to this meeting, and having conversations with your patrons and patrons from around the district, I applaud that. Waiting to the last minute is not the best solution for children. So we're here today. We met with Ms. Huey about a month ago, I think right after you had a board meeting, and asked when the next regular board meeting would be held. She told us, and we said we would be honored to be able to come and speak with you as a board of the community, to be able to bring you what we know the law says and what we've been through at the department several times, even in the 4 years that I've been there, and having to go through this difficult time of losing a school district as it's known today. So I'm going to stop there. I'm going to open up the questions from the board and try to answer any questions, clarify any of the information that I've tried to provide today. I've tried to bring the information that might be helpful to me if there are specific questions about what the law might say, etc. So Ms. Huey or Ms. Brown, are there any questions of the board about the situation?
First thing I would like to thank you for coming and sharing with us the direction of the decision to be taken. And one point of clarification on the project you spoke about,
thank you, Ms. Huey, when you spoke about the 1.1 million funding first and second year, could you just kind of clarify that again, please?
Yes, ma'am. The resulting school district, depending upon whether it's voluntary or involuntary, receives consolidation incentive funding. In the first year, which would be the school year 14-15, the resulting district then would receive that $1.1 million to help the transitioning into that new district. The next year, it's cut in half, so it's a little over $500,000 for next year.
But it doesn't stipulate how those funds are spent.
No. Actually, there are unrestricted funds. They're just like foundation funding is. The district, the resulting district, in that board, then determines how those dollars will be spent.
But as we stand now, this local board has full control of what happens with this district.
You have the option, yes, of looking for a partner who have a voluntary annexation consolidation up until March 1st. After March 1st, then it becomes an issue for the state to look at the bricks.
I don't think there's any more questions from the other.
Brown. It's been a pleasure to speak to you. I don't mind answering questions from the audience. There are questions that the audience would like to ask of the Department of Education. I'll try to answer those questions also. I can't give legal advice. I can only talk about what we know the law says and what we've had to deal with as an agency. So if there are questions from the audience, I'd be really happy to answer any questions that an audience member may have from that perspective.
Okay, Dr. Kimball has said that he would address questions, but I would like to say something before we start that. This is an opportunity for everyone's voice to be heard, and we certainly want to welcome that tonight. And we're going to do it in a respectful manner, because everyone, what comes out of your mouth is very important. So this is an opportunity to say what you want to say, but it's not a time for us to point fingers at individuals, because what we're looking at is what, the bottom line is, we're looking at what's best for students. So as we come forth and as we speak, let's think about what our words and our actions. Are we thinking of what's best for students and not what's best for individuals or adults? Because this is all about the students. So the floor is now open. We have a mic up front. And the way I'd like to do this is Dr. Kimball's on that side. If you would please come forward, state your name, and then state your comment or ask your question so that everyone can hear. Does that sound like a plan? Thank you. Who wants to come first? I think Ms. Touch is going to come first. Thank you.
As she's coming forward, Mr. Horton, I wanted to clarify. I was right the first time. It's $1.9 million the first year, and then almost $1 million the second year.
Equipment and the
this point in time, this elected board, this board that represents the current school district, Stevens School District, has the option of looking for a voluntary consolidation opportunity with a school district or school districts. So they have the option of looking at that option. Doesn't mean that it can't look at more than one option. But this area of district and consolidating here, and this one consolidating there. It doesn't mean it can't do that. But yes, the decision to bring forward a petition to the state board is left up to this board, and then the final decision of the state board would determine whether that petition is accepted or not.
So regardless of the people, if our board members don't represent what we want, then we don't get what we want. That's what you're saying.
What I'm saying is the people who are elected by the electorate of this school district were elected to make these decisions by law. So they do the best they can.
Opportunity.
Again, it would all depend upon what kind of agreements were made between those school districts and what this school board would determine. And then subsequently would have to fall back to the other laws that deal with legal transfers and school choice. So it gets a little more complicated at that point.
School district has afforded a lot of opportunities for Magnet students and also Stevens students. But what is in the best interest of our students? Putting them in a school district that has more opportunities outside of basketball, other extracurricular activities that can help them become a little bit more well-rounded. And also, our kids going to Camden having those same opportunities. I don't know how far it is from Stevens to go to Ralston, but being just 6 miles away and being able to be in a Magnolia school district, I think it would be a better position to put our students in. And also, going to Camden. So my thing is, we have to make sure we're doing what's in the best interest of our students. And yes, we elected our school board to have children's interest at heart, not our personal agendas.
Make sure that I give everyone an opportunity to speak or ask a question. So.
Splitting the district into two during all these options. So I don't see anything that this board, any decision that we make would be advantageous to our students. But at the end, it's still a decision of the board. I'm open to all positions, all of the positions at this time.
Is that the feeling of the other board members? I said, is that the feeling of the other board members as well?
My position is that we're here tonight to determine what's the best interest of our students. That's what this board has done, that's what this board has committed to do in the future.
And that is best interest for the children, and no one said anything about that, but yes, 40 miles to up there. Haven't even discussed about the school picking a bus to camp kids up there. So it's still in the area, so if you want to get 40 miles, it won't be my deal anymore, but.
We can't get it.
They all be going like 8 miles, 7 and 8 miles.
So I'm still in, I'm in favor of whatever the board decides. We haven't discussed it completely. We have this, best meeting we had was the last meeting we had over here. So it's still, working on it. My name is Jimmy Johnson. I'm a product of McNeil, Arkansas. And you know, really the issue is not the Georgia school. Our school board and the issue comes to get you off and you're not concerned. And they want to get small. Don't get quiet.
Can I speak? The more funding, the community donates,
those